Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhin istafa ma ba'd. Qala Allahu ta'ala fil Qur'an al-Majid wal Furqan al-Hamid. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صدق الله العظيم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم افتح علينا حكمتك وانشر علينا رحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم اللهم صل على محمد وفهمني بأسرار القرآن. Honorable ulama, brothers and sisters listening at home, Alhamdulillah, today is our third session of doing the dars of the Holy Quran. In our first session, I covered ta'awudh. In the second session, we covered Bismillahi Rahmani Rahim, and inshallah in today's session we'll be starting Surah Al-Fatihah. And as I mentioned last week, the whole purpose of us doing the Holy Quran and studying the Holy Quran and learning from the Holy Quran is so that we build connection with the Holy Quran. Quran has three fundamental rights. One is that we recite, the other is we understand the Quran, and third is we implement, we practice upon the teachings of the Holy Quran. If we have this in our life, then we will have barakah. If you recite the Holy Quran, if you understand the Quran, if we implement the Quran, then this will not only bring barakah on an individual, but to our family as well, to our household as well, to the town as well, to the city as well, to our country as well, and to the whole world. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ. This Quran is mubarak. Mubarak comes from blessing. If you recite it, then you will gain blessing. Unfortunately, what's the ax of that? What's the opposite of that? That if you don't recite the Holy Quran, if you abandon the Quran, then on an individual level, on a personal level, not only will the blessings be taken away from us, but this will be a source of destruction. Not on a personal level, but in our homes as well. Not just in our homes, but in our town as well. Not just in our town, but in our city as well. Not just in our city, but in the whole country as well. And not only in the whole country, but in the whole world as well. If we don't recite the Holy Quran. This is why Shaykhul Hind, rahmatullahi alayh, before the partition of India came, the whole area was called Hind. Shaykhul Hind, the Shaykh of Hind. He was imprisoned in Malta in the year 1916 for 3 years and 4 months. Shaykhul Hind was jailed in Malta and he stayed, how long? 3 years and 4 months. And whilst in his jail, he was able to reflect. You see, when a person don't have any distraction, he's able to reflect. He's able to ponder. This is why many people in jail, in prison, become Muslim. Why? Because they are able to reflect on life. This is why Nelson Mandela, many of us will know him. He lived for around 9 years. One third of his life was spent in Robben Island, approximately 33 years. What does he say? He said that being in that Robben Island changed my life. When I went inside, I was a different person. When I came out, I was a different person. Because I was able to reflect. And you're able to reflect. When you're able to reflect, you're able to see different things. This is why Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he used to do before he received prophethood? He used to go in Ghare Hira. And what did he used to do in Ghare Hira? Reflect. Reflection. So this is why it's very important that in our daily routine, we take time out to reflect. You know, our akabir, and there's a jama'at here, mashallah. Brothers, I requested to do nusra of the jama'at here. They've come all the way from Hong Kong to teach us about these things. So I'll give an example. One is doing tasbih. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. We are told to do tasbih. But one is doing tasbih with reflection, in seclusion. That has a different sweetness. That is on another level. When you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in seclusion. This is why our elders have stated that When we are doing dhikr, think and ponder. So don't just do dhikr without thinking, without pondering, without visualizing. Visualizing makes a big difference. When we're doing dhikr, think about, so for example, today's Thursday night, when we're reading Durood Sharif, think about that you're in Medina Munawwara. And then the noor, and then the way you will remember Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be different. By visualizing. This is why the greatest hadith, which all the Siha Sitta have mentioned, and all the muhaddithin have written in the kitab, is the hadith of Jibreel. In hadith of Jibreel, Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam asked three questions. Well, more than three questions. But the fundamental three questions was, Akhbirni anil Islam, Akhbirni anil Iman, and Akhbirni anil Ihsan. What is Ihsan? And what did Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam say? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Ihsan is that you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if He is looking at you. And if you can't do that, then you are as if you are looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you can't do this, then as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking at you. This is what Ihsan means. You visualize. And if you visualize and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will be on a different level when you do tasbih, when you do dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Shaykh al-Hind, after 3 years and 4 months, he is released and they take him to Bombay. And he is Shaykh al-Hind. So all the people in Diwan, they gather together. That after 3 years and 4 months, what will Shaykh al-Hind tell us? His first bayan is held. And what does he say? He says to the people out there, that in jail, I was able to reflect on the situation of Muslims. That why are Muslims so low? Why are they being attacked? Why is the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not coming to this ummah? And then he said, after that, that I have come to this conclusion that it's because of two reasons. One is because of our disunity. Because of our disunity. And the other is because of our abandoning of the Holy Quran. We've abandoned the Holy Quran. So the troubles, the attack are coming. This is why Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once he mentioned to the sahabas about the calamities which will be falling on this ummah. The sahabi asked, O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that time, what would be the way out? You know, nowadays, we have different reasons, we have different conclusion of things, that these things are happening, what should we do? Someone already asked Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this question, that what should the ummah do at that time? Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they need to hold on to the Quran, Kitabullah. So my brothers and sisters listening at home, this is the whole purpose of us doing the dars of the Holy Quran, is so that we connect ourselves with the Quran in terms of recitation, in terms of understanding. Because if we understand the Quran, then this will bring sweetness into our recitation. Because otherwise we'll just be reading. But just imagine reading and understanding what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say. So for example, in the session which I have now, I'll be doing the tafsir of Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Just Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And I want everyone to recite Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen with whatever knowledge we have. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And then I want everyone to recite Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen at the end. And then you will see the difference when we understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say. And then we read Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. What does it actually mean, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen? So brothers and sisters, before I do start the tafsir of Surah Al-Fatiha, I'd like to just mention few major points about Surah Al-Fatiha, what scholars have mentioned in the books. So the first surah which we will recite when you open the Holy Quran will be Surah Al-Fatiha. And what does Fatiha mean? The opener. Okay. Although chronologically, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق was the first verse revealed on Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But in terms of the first juz and the first part to be recited from the Holy Quran is Surah Al-Fatiha. So when Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam would come down with sometimes some verses of the Quran, sometimes a whole surah, He would tell Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where to place these surah, where to place these ayats. And this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha, was placed at the beginning. That's why it's called Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha means the opener. You have a cricket match and the two cricket players come. Who are they? They are the opener. You have Olympics. Before the Olympics starts, what you have? The opening ceremony. This, the opener, opens up the door. What's going to happen afterwards? Scholars have mentioned that this surah is not only called an opener because it's the first surah, because it opens up the Quran to us. It opens up what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to know from the Holy Quran. This is the opener, Surah Al-Fatihah. Through Surah Al-Fatihah, you will understand the Holy Quran. This is why it's called Al-Fatihah, the opener. And we see that when something is an opener, okay, it has to be something very important. For example, when you have a cricket team, who will you choose to be the opener? Those two batsmen who are the most important. Okay? So Surah Al-Fatiha is the opener. And not only the opener, but it's the most important part of the Holy Quran. Not only the opener, but also the most important part of the Holy Quran. This is why Surah Al-Fatiha is also known as Ummul Surah, Ummul Quran. The mother of all Quran is Surah Al-Fatiha. Umm means something which everything originates from. Ummul Kitab, the mother where everything originates from. This is what Surah Al-Fatiha is. And why does everything originates from Surah Al-Fatiha? Because in Surah Al-Fatiha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has summarized whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to mention in the Holy Quran. This is why Imam Fakhruddin Razi rahmatullahi alayhi writes in Tafsir Kabir that the whole Quran summary is mentioned in Surah Al-Fatiha. And Surah Al-Fatiha, the whole Quran's tafsir, the whole Quran summary is mentioned in Fatiha. And the whole summary of Surah Al-Fatiha is mentioned in Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And the whole summary of Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is mentioned in the letter Ba. The letter Ba. The khulasa of the whole Quran is in Surah Al-Fatiha. And we see that when something is khulasa, when something is a summary, it holds power. It holds importance. This is why Imam Shafi rahmatullahi alayhi would say that there's one surah. If only that one surah would have revealed, it would have been enough for the humanity. And what surah would he say? وَالْعَسْرَ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرَ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. When something is a khulasa, when something is a summary, it holds much importance. This is why Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam referred this surah as the greatest surah of the Holy Quran. You know, we know that the heart of the Quran is Surah Yasin. We all know this. Even our children will know this, that the heart of the Quran is Surah Yasin. The greatest ayah in the Holy Quran is what? Is Ayatul Kursi. It's one verse. The whole ayah is one verse. And it's the greatest ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about His Kursi. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Himself. But the greatest surah in the Holy Quran, scholars have mentioned, is Surah Al-Fatiha. Once Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in the masjid, and he said to Abu Sa'id radiallahu ta'ala, Abu Sa'id, before we leave this masjid, I want to teach you the greatest surah. So they were going out from the masjid. And Abu Sa'id radiallahu ta'ala anhu, for a moment thought that maybe Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has forgotten to teach me that surah. So he reminded Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the old Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just a while ago you were telling me that before we leave the masjid, you're going to teach me the greatest surah. What is that surah? Then Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the greatest surah in the Holy Quran is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Surah Al-Fatiha. And then he said that this is Sab'i Mathani. Sab'i Mathani. Sab'i Mathani means the seven most repeated verses in the Quran. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي. Seven most repeated. This is why scholars are unanimously agreed on this fact. The Surah Al-Fatiha has seven verses because of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying this hadith. So Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahmani Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'een, Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, Sirat al-Ladhina An'amta alayhim, Ghayri al-Maghdubi alayhim, Walad Dhalin. Seven verses. And not only seven verses, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's the most repeated. And I mentioned when we initially started this the dars of the Holy Quran. The how many times do we recite Surah Al-Fatihah? If we were to perform our salah, just the faraz and the sunnah. Faraz, let's leave the nafil out. Let's leave the sunnah ghair mu'akkada out. Just the sunnah mu'akkada and the faraz. That in a day, we will be reciting Surah Al-Fatihah 32 times. In a day, 32 times. If we multiply that in a year, that's 11,000 times. In a year, 11,000 times. If a person has been reading salah for let's say 50 years, a person passes away at the age of 65, so he's read namaz for 50 years. In his lifetime, he's read Surah Al-Fatiha 500 million times. 500 million times he has read Surah Al-Fatiha. If a person has only read salah for 25 years, he has read Surah Al-Fatiha in his salah 250 million times. My brothers and sisters listening at home, if a person recites 250 million times Surah Al-Fatiha, and in Surah Al-Fatiha he has recited, Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, O Allah, guide me towards the right path. Would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide him towards the right path? When he said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 250 million times in salah. This is what Surah Al-Fatiha is, my brothers and sisters. And Allahu Akbar. Not only Surah Al-Fatiha is a dua. Surah Al-Fatiha is not only a dua. But scholars have mentioned, and it comes in a hadith sharif, that when a person finishes reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, وَلَضَّالِّين, the angels say Ameen. The angels say Ameen. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith that you say Ameen as well. Because if your Ameen meets the Ameen of the angels, then all your sins will be forgiven. This is why Mufti Shabbir Sahib from Blackburn, he mentioned something very beautiful. That it is very sad to see and very sad to say that when we come to a Quran khatam and someone is completing the Holy Quran, mashallah, today we've got 7 Huffaz and they're completing the Holy Quran. Every time someone is reciting that surah and he comes to Walad Dhalin, he says Ameen, because he'll be saying Ameen. But we should be saying Ameen as well. We shouldn't just say quiet. We should be saying Ameen as well. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and it comes in Abu Dawood, that Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam taught me that when you finish Surah Al-Fatiha, then say Ameen. Because this is a seal. Just like you have a seal of a letter, Ameen is a seal of Surah Al-Fatiha. Ameen means, O Allah, accept. O Allah, accept. And let me go one stage further. When you're reading Surah Al-Fatiha, not only angels say Ameen, and not only angels participate when we're reading Surah Al-Fatiha, but it comes in hadith that even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala participates. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةِ بَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِسْفَيْنِ. And as-salah here means Surah Al-Fatiha. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have divided Surah Al-Fatiha in 2 parts equally. Now many people will have this question, that how can you half something which is 7? 7 verse. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةِ بَيْنَ عَبْدِ نِسْفَيْنِ. I have half divided Surah Al-Fatiha in 2 parts. First half is for me, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second half is for the servant. And then the hadith goes that when a person recites Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replies to that Surah Al-Fatiha, the Hamidani Abdi, that my Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised me. Then when someone says Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Athna Aliya Abdi, that this servant has exalted me. Then when someone says, that person says, Maliki Yawmiddin, then Majjadani Abdi. Then Iyyaka Na'budu Wa Iyyaka Nasta'in. If you were to study the verse, Iyyaka Na'budu Wa Iyyaka Nasta'in is actually half. Iyyaka Na'budu is to do with Allah. That, oh Allah, we will worship you. Wa Iyyaka Nasta'in is, oh Allah, we ask help. We ask help. So this is from us. And Iyyaka Na'budu is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Iyyaka Nasta'in is for us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, says, هَذَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ. The what he has asked here is one part is for me, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and one part is for him. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ, and for my servant is whatever he has asked. And then, اِهْدِنَا السِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ سِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ نَعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. These three verses, the last three verses, are for us, because we are asking guidance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَذَا لِعَبْدِي. What these three verses, these are for my servants, وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ, and for my servant is for whatever he has asked. So could you imagine? Could you visualize when you're performing your salah and you recite Surah Al-Fatiha with this belief, with this concentration, that after I'm reading Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is replying, Hamidani Abdi. When I say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, he is saying Athna Alayya Abdi. When I say Malik Yawmiddin, he is saying Majjadani Abdi. This is why it's called Ummul Kitab. It's the greatest surah. And this surah is also called the Surah of Shifa, the Surah of Cure. Why? Because of an incident which took place in the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Sa'id Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu narrates that we were once outside a tribe, and the chief of that tribe became ill, and there was no one there to cure that chief. So they came to us, a girl came to us and said to us that, is there someone in this group who can come and who can give cure, who can take this illness away from our chief? So the Sahaba says, and in one narration, Abu Sa'id radiallahu ta'ala says, we went and we looked at that chief, and then, and Abu Sa'id Khudri, and in one hadith, someone else recited Surah Al-Fatiha on this chief. And by reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, he became cured, this person. Because he became cured, he gave 30 sheep to the Sahabas as a hadiya. So now the Sahabas were worried that, is this ujra? Is this taking, is this earning money through Fatiha? We've recited Surah Al-Fatiha, this should have been done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and here we're taking remuneration, we're taking something for Surah Al-Fatiha. So is this, are these 30 sheep halal for us? So we should eat from these. We should go back and ask Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they went back and they asked Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Though Nabi Kareem sallallahu, this is what happened. And they gave, that chief gave us 30 sheep. What should we do with that? Is it permissible for us to eat? Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first said, "The who taught you? I never told you that Surah Al-Fatiha has got cure." And then Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Yes, Surah Al-Fatiha is a cure for illnesses." And then he said, "And these 30 sheep which you've been given, they are permissible for you. And leave some part for me as well." So it's called Surah Al-Shifa, it's called the Ummul Kitab, and it's called Surah Al-Fa. And there are many other names to this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha. So let's start. Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So as I mentioned in our first session, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم is read so that we seek refuge in Allah from shaitan. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم means we start in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Ar-Rahman, who is Ar-Rahim. So I want you to visualize, I want you to think that when someone moves into a new house or into an old house, he's bought a new house, what's the first thing he'll do? He'll go inside and he'll take everything what he doesn't need. There'll be things in that house which he doesn't require. So he will take all that thing out. Then what will he do? Then he will decorate the house. Meaning he will make that house such so that his family can move in. The carpets are done, the wallpapers are done. Okay, so it becomes livable. And then what will he do? The family will move in, and then they will worry, and they will bring and they will buy the most important appliances. This is why when someone moves in, okay, people are, they're not sure what gift to buy. So they sometimes ask, "Oh person, you've just bought a new house, what shall we gift you? What shall we, because we don't want to buy anything, something which is so important." So the person then mentions something which is so important for them. If it's a big family, you might say washing machine, because that's something which is so important for that family. So when we are reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, when we've read A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem, we have taken shaitan away. A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem means that I seek refuge in Allah from shaitan, in Allah from shaitan, meaning I am going to recite the Holy Quran, shaitan move away. And then, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, now I am going to start with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. Then, what's the most important thing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most important thing is Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah. All praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I will mention why Alhamdulillah is so important. And why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bought this word, Alhamdulillah. Because He could have bought any other word. You know, Arabic is such a unique language, such a rich language, that just for the word praise, okay, you could read, you could say madah, you could say shukr. There are so many other words which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have used here. But He used Alhamd, He used the word Alhamd. Saying that every other word is restricted in praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Alhamd, if you look in the dictionary, and if you ask scholars, Alhamd means combination of praise and shukr. Alhamd means a combination of praise and shukr. So when someone says Alhamdu, he's not actually just praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's actually praising and thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if it was only madh, madh means praise. Madh means praise. And if it was any other word which praised, then that would have just been praise to Allah. And praise is restricted. Because, for example, praise is general. Okay, you praise anyone. I could say that person, mashallah, he's such a wealthy person. Mashallah, that person is such a strong person. He's got no connection with me. Praise is general. I can thank anyone. It doesn't have to be connected to me. But praise is restricted in expression. Because you can only praise with verbally. You can't praise in your heart or with your limb. So in that sense, it's restricted in expressing. But in the context, it's general. You can praise anyone. Shukr, again, is restricted. Why? Because shukr is not general. Shukr will only be done to that person who has done something to you. You can't say, mashallah, I thank that person, he's very tall or he's very rich. Because he's done nothing to you, so you won't thank him. You only thank that person who has done something to you. So shukr is restricted to only that thing who has some connection with you. But in terms of expression, it's not restricted. Because you can do shukr with your tongue, you can do shukr with your heart, you can do shukr with your hands. This is why Ibn Qayyim Jawzi rahmatullahi alayhi says, there are three types of shukr. One is with your heart, one is with your tongue, and one is with your limbs. So praise, in terms of expression, is restricted. But in terms of the context, is general. Shukr, in terms of expression, is general. But in terms of context, who you can do shukr, is restricted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then used a word which has both Alhamd and Ash-Shukr. The praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we are praising you, at the same time, we are doing shukr of you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Praise and shukr at the same time. This is why Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Masnoon du'as, when he would finish eating, what would he say? Alhamdulillah. Why? Not just praising, he is thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that food. He is coming out of toilet, ghufranak, alhamdulillah. Because you are not just praising, you are thanking. Alhamdulillah is thanking. But at the same time, he's praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he would finish his work by saying alhamdulillah. Showing us that alhamdulillah is praising and also thanking. And just these two things is the khulas of our daily routine. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, alhamdulillah. Wherever you start, start with Bismillah. Whenever you finish, you finish with Alhamdulillah. This is the khulasa of the whole Quran. This is the khulasa of our daily routine. You start anything, start with Bismillah. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and I mentioned last week, that whatever thing is not started with Bismillah, then it is incomplete. Abatar. Whatever you start with Bismillah. And whenever you finish something, you finish with Alhamdulillah. Because you are not only thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you are also praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why when someone praises with this term, Alhamdulillah, what is Alhamdulillah in hadith comes? Tahmeed. Tahmeed means to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the words Alhamdulillah. There are two major ways of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One is tahmeed and one is tasbih. One is tahmeed, which is Alhamdulillah, and one is tasbih, which is Subhanallah. Subhanallah, what is Subhanallah? Subhanallah means munazzah anil nuqs, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from every weakness, every blemish. When a person is far away, is free from every blemish, every weak, then you are actually glorifying him. This is another way of glorifying something. When you say that someone is free from every weakness, every illness, or every defect, you are actually praising that person. This is what Subhanallah means. This is why Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu ta'ala, he was a poet at the time of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would sometimes tell him that, oh Hassan, sit on the minbar and tell us a few poetry. And he would say poetry to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to the Sahabas. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would become happy and he would make dua for Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu ta'ala an mentioned one poetry in his life, which is such, scholars have mentioned, from the time of Nabiya Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam till the last person, whatever poetry someone has said, you put that on one scale and you put this one poetry, which is a four sentence, on the other scale. The poetry of Hassan bin Thabit, which is of four sentences, will outweigh every other poetry whoever has said. And what were these words? He said, أَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَ قَتْتُ عَيْنِي وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءِ خُلِقَتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقَتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. The Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَ قَتْتُ عَيْنِي. You are such that my eyes has never seen anyone better than you. وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءِ, that no mother has ever given birth to anyone who is more handsome than you. And then he says, this is the point which I want to say, خُلِقَتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ. The Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you were created free from every defect. Praising this way is glorifying that person. وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَ قَتْتُ عَيْنِي وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءِ خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you were created as if how you wanted to be created. So this is another way of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by saying Subhanallah, Subhanallah. This is why the translation of Subhanallah is glory be to Allah. Because when someone is free from every nooks, every defect, he is glorified. He is Subhanallah. This is why you will find that Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he used to teach the Sahabas the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would always teach these two, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah. Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha comes and she complains. And we all know this story, that she wanted a slave to help her in her daily chores. What did Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam give her with? Subhanallah 33 times, and then Alhamdulillah 33 times, and then Allahu Akbar 34 times. Every time he would say Subhanallah, read Subhanallah, and Alhamdulillah, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah. They both come together in many places. This is why Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi finishes his Bukhari kitab, his Bukhari Sharif kalima. And Nabiya Kareem sallallahu, and he narrates the last hadith, he narrates, كَلِمَتَانِ حَبِيبَتَانِ لِلرَّحْمَنِ خَفِيفَتَانِ عَلَى اللِّثَانِ ثقيلتان في الميزان سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله الحمد لله سبحان الله وبحمده. This is why when a person, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His mercy enter Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran that when a person will enter Jannah, when a person will enter Jannah, دعواهم فيها سبحانك اللهم. The Mufassirin here has written that when a person will enter Jannah, دعواهم, their dua in Jannah will be سبحانك اللهم, سبحانك اللهم. So in Ruhul Ma'ani it comes that in Jannah your dua will be سبحانك اللهم. What does that mean? It comes in Ruhul Ma'ani that Allah, we've all heard this, that in Jannah you can do whatever. In Jannah you can do whatever. And you can wish for whatever. Whatever you will wish, whatever you want, that will be granted. But how will it be granted? What will you have to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that thing to be granted? Okay? For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says whenever He wants to create anything, He says kun fayakun. He says kun fayakun. He doesn't even need to say kun fayakun. But He wants to explain this. Kun fayakun. So in Jannah, when the believers will want something, what will you have to say? Wallah, I want this. No. The secret code in Jannah will be Subhanakallahumma. Just by saying Subhanakallahumma, and then whatever he will say, that will come. Subhanakallahumma. 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 And this is how we start the salah as well. We start the salah with Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika wa tabaraka ismuka wa ta'ala jadduka wa la ilaha ghayruk. The code for Jannah, Subhanakallahumma. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, every time together. Not every time, but a lot of times. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah. Once a person came to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, oh Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala, who raised this, that someone came to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, oh Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the world has abandoned me. Meaning I am in poverty. Teach me something so that I can, this poverty goes away. Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, have you forgotten the prayers of angels and the tasbih of the creations? Have you forgotten this? Read them. And what did Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mean by this? Now why don't you recite Subhanallah wa bihamdi, Subhanallah al-azim, Astaghfirullah 100 times at dawn. And inshallah your poverty will be removed. Subhanallah wa bihamdi, Subhanallah al-azim, Astaghfirullah 100 times at dawn. Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu raised, this person did this. And after some time he came back to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, oh Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the world has come to me in such a way that it's hard for me to take care of the wealth which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me. These are the du'as which Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us. Even last week I mentioned regarding Surah Al-Waqi'ah. This is something which we should be reciting. Whoever recites Surah Al-Waqi'ah night time, poverty will never afflict the house. Then some people will have this objection. No objection, but question. And Mawlana, we've been reciting Surah Al-Waqi'ah. We've been reciting this dua which you've told us. We're still in poverty. Then I want brothers and sisters to remember one thing. And that is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, it comes in hadith, that لو أنكم توكلون, that the promise of me giving you rizq is on your tawakkul, is on your trust in me. You need to trust me, then rizq will come to you. You can't be just reciting all this for testing, or will it happen, or just, you need to have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you. Not belief. There's a difference between belief and trust. We believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's a raziq, He will give us. But there's a difference between belief and trust. I'll give you an example so people understand. There's two buildings. And someone puts a pole between one building to another building. And there's a person out there, okay? And he wants to break the Guinness Book of Record. So he says, I'll be able to walk from that building to the other building. Not just by myself, but I will have my child on top of me. And I promise that I can walk from that building to the other building. And he has a stick Okay? And he puts his child at the back and he walks. And he walks, and he walks, and he walks. And he goes from one building to another building. And he says to everyone, "Oh, everyone, do you believe that I can do this?" So everyone in one go says, "What? Yes, we believe because we've seen it. We believe. We believe." And then he says, I want to go back. "Is there anyone of you who will give me their child? Is there anyone of you who will give me?" And there's utter silence. No one wants to give their child. There's a difference between belief and difference between trust. They believed in him, but did they trust in him? No. We have believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but do we have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is why Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Law annakum tawakkalun." If you trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then just like the birds, they don't need to go to work. Just like Allah will feed them, and they will come back home with their bellies full. Oh humans, if you trust, then I will do the same with you. Not just belief, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, as I was mentioning, Subhanallah is a praise, and Alhamdulillah is a praise. So Alhamdulillah, I'll go back to Alhamdulillah. So Alhamdulillah means what? You're praising, and you're thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one go. And this, I'm just explaining Alhamdulillah, and this is just on a surface level. Because even me, before, I used to think, that how can people wrote so much tafsir of the Holy Quran? You know, we've just spent, I don't know, 15 minutes just on Alhamdulillah. Mufassireen have done this with every word. Could you believe it? This is why Tafsir Ibn Radi is about 32 volumes. Tafsir Tabari is about 28 volumes. Every word, they've gone so deep so that we understand what each word means. Alhamdulillah. And then, so when we say Alhamdulillah, it means all praise, and at the same time we are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, li. The next word, the next letter is li. For who? Allah. For Allah. Now last week I mentioned a lot of things about Allah, so I won't go through. But Allah is the ism that of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is that name which has all the qualities in him. So when we say Allah, that means that we are saying Allah together with all its quality. This is why some scholars have mentioned that Allah is Ismi Dhat and Allah is Ismi Azam. Imam Abu Hanifa and others have stated that Ismi Azam are those words which anyone who makes dua through them, their dua is accepted. So Imam Abu Hanifa has stated that Allah is Ismi Azam. That's how powerful the word Allah is. So when we say Alhamdu, thank and shukr, for who? For who? Then thanks and shukr is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what Tawheed means. Tawheed means that thank and shukr is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah. Allahu Akbar. Now when you open up the translation of the Holy Quran, okay, you will come across this. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the Lord of the world. The question is, Alhamdu is one word, and all praise is two words. So where have you got the translation of all from? All. Alhamdu is one word, and all praise is two words. You see, just a bit of Arabic lesson here. Alhamdu has got alif lam at the beginning. At the beginning, Alhamdu. When a word has alif lam at the beginning, okay, it makes a non-specific specific. So for example, you have kursi. Kursi is non-specific. If you say, so kursi means a chair. If you say al-kursi, it means the chair. Qalamun means a pen. Al-qalam means the pen. It makes something which is general, specific, the, okay? But it has another meaning as well. Al also means istighraq. Istighraq means that whatever you're saying, it encompasses entirety of that. So for example, I'll give you an example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, which I mentioned in before, Surah Al-Asr, Wal-Asr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath on zamana, on time. Innal insan, verily al-insan, innal insan, al-insan. That alif lam means every human being. Every human being. That alif lam means istighraq, means encompassing every human being is in khusr. Innal insan lafi khusr. When we say Alhamdulillah, that alif lam means every praise, whichever done will be done. Every type of praise, Alhamdulillah, is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what al means. Alhamdu. Every type of praise is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the scholars have mentioned, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala start Surah Al-Fatiha like how he started other surahs? He started other surahs like Sabbaha lillahi ma fi samawat, meaning with a verb. Yusabbihu lillahi, these are verb. Verb has tense, past, present and future. And Alhamdu is a noun. Why? Because if this surah would have been started with a verb, then verb is restricted. Because either it's past tense, then you're going to leave present and future. Either it would have been future, either it would have been present, then you're going to leave the other two tense. Either it would have been future, it would have left present and past. So to encompass every praise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used Alhamdulillah. Allah. Could you imagine how powerful this word is? This is why Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Alhamdulillah tamla'ul mizan. Alhamdulillah is so powerful in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It fills the scale of Allah. Alhamdulillah tamla'ul mizan. Now the question is, all praise is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now describes himself. Alhamdulillahi. Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Rabbil alameen. He is the Lord of the world. Rabb and al-alameen. You see, what does a Rabb mean? Rabb has many meanings. So for example, when we read Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the letter Ba has got so many meanings. It could mean isti'ana, it could mean ilsaq, it could mean many other meaning could be given to the letter Ba. Similarly, a word can have many meaning. So Rabb can have many meaning and has many meaning. Rabb also means owner. Rabb also means a person who is in charge. This is why many tafsir you will find the owner of the world. Rabb also means master of the world. Because Rabb has all these different connotations, all these different meanings. So Rabb can also mean owner. It also means in charge. It also comes from Murabbi, the one who nourishes. From nothing, he gradually grows something. That's also called Rabb. Gradually growing something is also called Rabb. Okay? So all these different meanings. And the last one is Qayyim. Rabb can also mean Qayyim, the one who sustains. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not only the owner of this world, but He is also the in charge of this world. Because sometimes you can have something which you own, but you're not in charge of that. You don't have the permission of doing things on there. You own it, but you don't have the permission. So you own, He is also in charge. He is also Rabb, meaning He is also gradually growing things in this world. This is why everything which we see is growing. Everything started from nothing and is growing gradually. We were all nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينُ مِنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُرًا. That did a time pass عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ on humanity that they were even worth mentioning. لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created and He's gradually growing us. And He's growing the whole world. And this is why Mufassirin have written under وَسَمَا بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدِي وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is expanding the universe as well. Growing. And then a time will come when that growth will come to an end. And when that growth will come to an end, that means the world will finish. The world will come to an end. Started with nothing, the world will come to an end, and again there'll be nothing. There'll be nothing. This is why in Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Kullu man 'alayha fan." Everything will perish. There'll be nothing. This is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "Liman al-mulku al-yawm? Liman al-mulku al-yawm? Whose kingdom is it today?" And there'll be nothing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, Mufassirin have written that even angels will perish. Even angels, Israel will perish. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will recreate everything. So this is Rabb, gradually growing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Qayyim. He's not only gradually growing, but He's also sustaining. You can grow a plant, okay? But if you don't sustain it, then that plant is gonna die. He's also sustaining. Now I mentioned last week, okay, that we are sustained in this world. Why? Through oxygen. And I mentioned through stats. Few stats on oxygen. How many liters we breathe in. And how much oxygen we breathe in. Okay, I don't want to go through the whole stats again. But I'll just mention one thing. Qayyim. He is sustaining this world. This oxygen which we see. Okay, we breathe in about 21%. Is there a plant out there who is regulating all this oxygen in the world? Science says, okay, you can do your own research on this. Okay? I want everyone to do this, okay? Don't breathe, don't inhale oxygen for 5 seconds. Breathe in. We've not inhaled oxygen for 5 seconds. Anything happen to us? Did we die? Anything happen at home? Nothing. Science says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to take oxygen out from this world, there was no oxygen, for not 1 month, for not 1 day, for not 1 hour, for not 1 minute, for 5 seconds. How much? 5 seconds. He took all the oxygen out, this world would perish. 5 seconds, 5 seconds. He took oxygen out, this world would finish. I don't want to explain how, but the word would finish. This is Qayyim. He is not only growing, He is sustaining us. He is sustaining us. This is what Rabb is. This is what Rabb is. This is why in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses our parent as He uses, when He talks about parents, He uses the same word, Rabb. Why? Because just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is growing us, our parents are doing the same job for us. When we were small, when we didn't know anything, we were in our mother's womb, when we were born, they are making us, they are sustaining us, they are making us gradually grow. So in the quality of Rabb, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rabb in its entirety. But in one sense, our parents have got this quality of Rabb. Of Rabb in the sense of making us gradually growing. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that after me, the next right after me is the right of parents. Because they are doing the same thing. They are gradually making you grow. From nothing, you were there, you came into your mother's womb, and you are growing. Where does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about parents, that regarding your parents, make this dua, رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts this dua as well. He could have started with Allahumma, but no, رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا. Oh Allah, have mercy on both of them. كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي, just like they nourished me. When I was small, صَغِيرًا, when I was small. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, say good things about them, make dua for them. And then in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, I am also teaching you the dua which you should be reading. And this is a dua. You know, from all the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? Ar-Rahman. This is why Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when a person, when a child is born, two names which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the most is Abdullah and Abdul Rahman. Ar-Rahman. From all the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rahman is the greatest quality. This is why it is mentioned in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That's why it is mentioned in Surah al-Fatiha. There's a whole Surah ar-Rahman. Now, person, you may not know what to ask for your parents. You may not know what to ask for your parents. What dua to make on behalf of you? I am teaching you the greatest quality which I have is Rahman. Ask for that for your parents. رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. So this is a dua which we should be reciting so much so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon our parents. This is who Rabb is gradually making us grow. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He is Rabb, He is Master, He is the owner, He is in charge, He is a sustainer of what? Of just the world, of this earth? Of this earth? No. Al-Alameen. Al-Alameen. Al-Alameen is the plural of the worlds. Different Mufassirin have written different things about Al-Alameen. But Al-Alameen, in a summary, means everything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Alameen. He is the Rabb of everything. Al-Alameen. This is what it means. Not just seven earths. No, Al-Alameen means every single thing other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the Rabb of everything. Al-Alameen. Now we live on this earth. Just yesterday, I was walking. Many will have seen the moon. It looks so near. Okay. I just want to mention how big this earth is and how big this world is. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He is a Rabb of Alameen, what does He actually mean? So that moon which I saw yesterday looked like as if it's our neighbor. But from us to that moon, there's approximately 200,000 miles. From here to the moon, 200,000 miles. You could fit approximately 30 earth from here to the moon. That's how far away that moon is. How far is the sun from here? 93 million miles. From here, from earth, 93 million miles. Now we all know sun is a star. It's not a planet. And star is gas. Okay? It gives energy, it gives heat. If the sun was physical, if it had a shape, physical shape, and if it was hollow, then they say you could fit 1.3 million earth inside the sun. 1.3 million earth, this earth, in the sun. If it had a physical shape, and if it was hollow, and if we had to put this earth inside, 1.3 million earth would have fit inside. And this sun, with all its planets, okay, and this sun, which is a star, is only one star from the millions and billions of stars, which is far greater than the sun. So this sun and our planets and the moon and whatever is called what? Solar system. It's called the solar system. Like this, there are millions of solar system. And our solar system, with all its other million solar system, is called what? Milky Way. Milky Way. How many Milky Ways are there? How many galaxies? So Milky Way is our galaxy. How many galaxies are there? The Hubble telescope, once they did research, they said there's about 100 million. The scientists said, no, there's probably more. Billions of galaxies. Billions of galaxies. Just with the telescope, which is observable, universe, we can see, okay, up to, in that telescope, 46 billion light years away. So the speed of light is 186,000 miles per second is the speed of light. Speed of 186,000 per second. So we're not talking about per minute, per month, per year. 46 billion light years away. That's the furthest and observable universe we can see. 46 billion. And science says, I'm just talking what we've learned, the observable world which we can see is only 4%. Is only 4%. 96% is we don't even know. 96%. That's how huge this universe is. That's how huge this universe is. We can't even comprehend. And Nabi Kareem said, Allah said, all this, and Mufassirin have written, all this is under the first heaven. All this is under the first heaven. The second heaven is far greater than the first heaven. The third is far greater than the second. The fourth is far greater than the third. The fifth is, and the sixth, and the seventh is far greater. Nabi Kareem said, Allah said, 500 miles. We don't know which miles, but that's how great it goes to seven. And then Nabi Kareem said, Allah said, on top of all this is the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. His kursi extends the heavens and the earth. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Nabi Karim said, then thereafter said, what's the relation of kursi and the heavens? He said, just like if you were to put a ring in a desert. In a ring in a desert. How insignificant, how small would that ring be? That's how the comparison is between the kursi and everything beneath. And then on top of the kursi is the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On top of the kursi, the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Nabi Karim is on water. The arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, he is Rabbul Alameen. He is the master of all everything. This is what it means. And because it's Thursday night, okay, I just like to mention a few things about Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well. This starts, okay, shows us how arsh is Allah. But this is why it comes that on the day of Qiyamah, وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ ثَمَانِيَ. Eight angels will be used to carry the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sa'ad ibn Mu'az radiallahu ta'ala, when he passed away, Sa'ad ibn Mu'az, you know, those who followed Seerah, they will know that the Badriyin Sahabi were the top Sahabi. No one could mess with them, Badriyin Sahabi. The Badr, when Badr happened, before Badr, Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know whether to fight with them. Okay, I won't go because the story is too long. But Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted Mashwira from the Ansar, that should he fight? Because Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know whether the Ansar would be ready to fight in this battle or not. Because Al-Ansar said that we will help you when you're in Medina, and Badr is outside Medina. So Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to know that this is outside Medina, would the Ansar help us? This is when Sa'ad ibn Mu'az radiallahu ta'ala anhu gave that khutbah to Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That, oh Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are outside Medina, but we will not leave you. We are going to participate in this battle. You tell us to plunge in the sea, we will plunge after you. We will plunge for you. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got so happy with this reply, Sa'ad ibn Mu'az radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sa'ad ibn Mu'az radiallahu ta'ala anhu, after the battle of Trench, he passed away. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, upon the death of Sa'ad ibn Mu'az, even the arsh shook. Allahu Akbar. This is who Sa'ad ibn Mu'az radiallahu. So what I wanted to mention about Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if arsh is there, and it's beyond our comprehension, there's no digits, I can't bring any calculator here to actually say the greatness of kursi and then the arsh and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then what about the maqam of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sitting in the house, is sleeping in the house of Hani radiallahu ta'ala an, and Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam comes. Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam comes. And, you know, for example, if there's a sheikh, and if I have to wake him up, if there's a sheikh, a big maulana, and if I have to wake him up, okay, I'll be sat there, and I'll be stood there, and I won't know how to wake him up. I'm like, shall I touch him on his shoulder? Shall I say something? Shall I say assalamu alaikum? Shall I touch his foot? Okay? When you have to wake someone who's so great, then sometimes you're puzzled as to how you're going to wake that person up. Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam didn't know how to wake Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam up. So he's thinking how to wake Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam up. So someone has actually put this picture in a poetry. Someone has actually put this in a poetry. Who? Maulana Anas Sahib. Maulana Anas Yunus from Pakistan. He recites Nasheed. He has put this, the whole incident, in his Nizam. Maulana Anas Sahib says, I read this Nizam in Madinah al-Munawwara to the ulamas of Madinah Munawwara. And I came to this part. And I read it. I read the whole Nizam, the whole Nasheed. And then I came back to Pakistan. When I came back to Pakistan, someone rang me from Madinah Munawwara. And Maulana Anasab, that day in Madinah Munawwara, you read a Nizam. Someone in that majlis saw Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that person saw Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, tell Anas to repeat these words, what he said. I thought I'll just make you listen to it. I've got it on my phone. So those who don't understand Urdu, Talwa means soul, this. The bottom of our foot means Talwa. So he's reading that same part, okay, which Nabi Kareem told him to recite.
جس کے بارے میں مجھے صالح نے کہا کہ اللہ کے نبی نے کہا بار بار پڑھو وہ شعر یہ ہے سننا معراج کی رات اللہ نے جبریل کو بھیجا جاؤ آج میرے محبوب کو لاؤ جبریل آئے ہمارے نبی آرام کر رہے تھے سو رہے تھے سوچا نیند سے کیسے اٹھاؤں بے ادبی نہ ہو جائے عاشق معشوق کا معاملہ ہے گستاخی نہ ہو جائے کہا یا اللہ آپ کا محبوب سو رہا ہے سلام کر لوں آنکھ کھل جائے نہیں نیند خراب ہو یا اللہ تھوڑا ہلا دوں آنکھ کھل جائے نہیں کھٹکھٹا دوں آنکھ کھل جائے نہیں نیند خراب ہو اب جبریل بھی پریشان کہ نیند سے کیسے اٹھاؤں اللہ کے پاس لے جانا ہے براق آیا ہوا ہے کیسے لے جاؤں کہ اللہ مجھے طریقہ نہیں آ رہا نیند سے کیسے اٹھاؤں اللہ نے فرمایا جبریل میں نے تجھے بھیجا ہے طریقہ بھی میں بتاتا ہوں کہو نا صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم اللہ نے فرمایا جبریل تو ایسے کر تو ماتھے پہ آنکھ ناک کان ہونٹ گال کہاں کسن تو
Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam woke Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So those who didn't understand Urdu, okay, Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam was told that with your tongue kiss the soul of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and like this wake Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam woke up. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then sat on the buraq And then he is taken. He is taken to different places. And then he is taken to Al-Aqsa. And then from Aqsa, he is now elevating. From this universe, which we only know of 4%. From this universe, he goes to first heaven, second heaven, third heaven, fourth heaven, fifth heaven, sixth heaven, seventh heaven. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I meet all the angels there. I even meet Malik, who is the God of Jahannam. And then I see Sidratul Muntaha. Sidratul Muntaha. And then Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, now I observed something, that 70,000 angels were doing tawaf. Angel Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam said, this is Baytul Ma'amur. And then many other things happen. So this is past. First, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. And then Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam says to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasalam, no one has ever passed this. No one has ever. Over there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I pass this border, I will perish. O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are the only one who has been given this permission to pass this. You go. And he walks, and he walks, and he goes past 70,000 noor. And there, وَهُوَ بِالْأُفُقِ الْأَعْلَى. And there he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there he converses with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is who Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is. Such a conversation, the muhaddithin have written that some of the conversation which Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had was so secret that even we don't know what he spoke at that time. Even we don't know what he spoke at that time. This is why once Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha did something, and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became so happy with Aisha Siddiqa that he said, oh Aisha Siddiqa, ask me anything, I will answer your question. So Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha at that time thought, this is an opportunity where I can ask anything and Prophet ﷺ will answer. So he goes to her father, Hazrat Abubakr radiallahu ta'ala, and he says to Abubakr, oh Abubakr radiallahu, my father, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said this, you can ask anything, I will answer. Oh my father, what should I ask Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What does Hazrat Abubakr says? Hazrat Abubakr radiallahu ta'ala, and he says, oh Aisha Siddiqa, oh my daughter, when you go to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reveal some conversation which you had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Something which you converse with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just reveal that. And she goes and she asks. And Nabi Kareem says, this does answer. Allahu Akbar. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is conversing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you know when we go Makkah al-Mukarramah, Medina al-Munawwarah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us all. Okay? One of the hardest tasks is the return. Okay, why? Because we need to take gifts. Gifts for our family, gifts for our relatives. We have to take something back. So it's the time for Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to leave the mulaqat with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're going back. Take this gift. This is a gift for you and for your ummah. And what was our gift? As-salah. As-salah. Salah. Salah. Namaz. Prayer. Which was given as a gift by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for us. No other ibadah was given there except for salah, to show the importance of salah. And my brothers and sisters, how sad it is, and how sad is it that we've abandoned salah. We don't even read salah. That Allah, who is Rabbul Alameen, who has given us everything, he has said, live your life. Yeah. Just spend a couple of minutes in salah. Couple of minutes. Fajr, Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. And we can't even do that. Allahu Akbar. What answer will you give on the day of judgment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He will ask us, why did you not read salah? Oh Allah, I was too lazy. Oh Allah, it was what? You know, this is why it is stated that, you know, when you go to hospital in A&E, they do preliminary test. When they do preliminary test, they want to check how serious it is. If it's too serious, then in that test, they'll take you straight in. Okay? In Qabr, a preliminary test is taken. And in the Day of Judgment, a preliminary test is taken. When we're in Qabr, the preliminary test is Ma Rabbuk, Ma Deenuk, and who is this? Meaning Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If we pass that, then Barzakh is easy. That's the initial test. And then everything is easy. The initial test on the Day of Judgment is, Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when everyone will get up, the first thing to be asked to everyone will be As-Salah. If you pass, then every other stage will become easy. If you fail on that first stage of Salah, then Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, every other stage will become hard. So brothers and sisters, I requested that we perform Salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this as a gift. And yet we are abandoning performing Salah. Come for Isha's at 7:15, in other masjid at 7:45. And even then we see 2 saf, 3 saf. We should be coming in the masjid and performing our Salah and making Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala happy. So my brothers, this is the maqam of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he goes and meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my brothers, as I said in the beginning, now when we read Alhamdu lillahi rabbil alameen, it should be a different meaning. This is who Alhamdulillah. All praise is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is a Rabb of al-alameen, of everything. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. This is why, and I'll finish it because I've taken too much time. This is why, as I mentioned, Bismillah should be written, should be said at the beginning, and Alhamdulillah should be said at the end, because Alhamdulillah, you are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when people will go into Jannah, Subhanaka Allahumma, da'wahum fiha Subhanaka Allahumma. Okay? Wa tahiyyatuhum fiha salam. And the greeting in Jannah will be salam, salam. Mufti Shafi Usmani rahmatullahi alayhi writes that, you know, salam by who will greet us? Okay? When you go somewhere into an event, okay, and you're the VIP, okay, then people will be greeting you. As you're going inside the event, people will be greeting you. As Muslim will enter Jannah, there'll be greeting coming. In one narration, this greeting will be coming from the angels. But in one narration, which is mentioned in Surah Yasin as well, Salam qawlam min Rabbir Rahim. This salam will be coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Da'wahum fiha subhanaka Allahumma wa tahiyyatuhum fiha salam. Wa akhiru da'wahum. And the last dua, and the last prayer will be wa akhiru da'wahum an Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa akhiru da'wahum anil Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. If the first verse is Surah Al-Fat, is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. The last, wa akhiru da'wahum anil Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. This is why Imam Qurtubi rahmatullahi alayhi writes that when we're finishing our dua, you will see the Imam Sahib, you will see Imam Sahib, and you will have learned this, that when you're finishing the dua, okay, one of the etiquettes is that we finish the dua by reading Subhana Rabbika Rabbil Izzati Amma Yusifun Wasalamun, again Salam Wasalamun Ala Al-Mursaleen Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Over there as well. So my brothers and sisters, this is what Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen teaches us, that always praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our day and our night should be spent in praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever time we get, this is why, and inshallah, the jama'at is here from Hong Kong, inshallah they'll be doing tashkil, okay? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for every action, He has a limit. Salah, read 5 times. Fasting,
30 days. For everything is limit. But when it comes to remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu dhkuru Allah dhikran kathira. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot. A lot has been. Meaning, our life should be in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by reciting subhanallah, alhamdulillah, by doing those things which makes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala happy. If we are doing this, then what the world is looking for? The world is looking for what? Happiness. Allah bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innu al-qulub. You will find happiness in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by reciting subhanallah, by reciting alhamdulillah excessively. Your heart will be content by the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, next week we will carry on with Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. So this was a short tafsir on Surah Al-Fatiha, the first verse. Alhamdulillah, there's a jamaat here from Hong Kong. And I will request the jamaat to say a few words so that it will benefit myself and those who are sat here. And inshallah, the jamaat will be doing some tashkil as well.
بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم بس ساری بات تو کرنے کے بعد بھی کچھ الفاظ باقی نہیں رہ گئے اور جس طرح کھول کے صرف ایک اللہ کی جو ہے تعریف کے بارے میں مولانا صاحب نے بیان فرمایا تو اگر اب بھی ہمیں سمجھ نہ آئے تو بھئی پھر تو انسان اور اگر اب بھی ہے بندہ مرد ہو یا عورت گھر میں بیٹھا رہے تو بھی بات سمجھ نہیں اتنے کریم اللہ اور اتنی مطلب ہے کہ جو حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی ذات مبارک کس طرح بھی تو اس کے بعد یہ اس اللہ کا تعارف کرانا لوگوں کو بھی بتانا جو اللہ سے دور ہیں اور جس طرح مولانا صاحب نے ارشاد فرمایا کہ بھائی نماز اتنا بات سمجھانے کے بعد اللہ نے کیا تحفہ دیا نماز کا وہی امت چھوڑ کے بیٹھی ہوئی تبلیغ اللہ جانتا ہے کچھ بھی نہیں لوگوں کو جا کر اللہ سے دوستی لگوا صرف منتے پاؤں پکڑو ہمیں تو جائے لوگ ہیں کہتے ہیں ہم تو بگاڑنے والے ہیں پر لوگوں کے پاؤں پکڑ سکتے ہیں اپنی پگڑی پاؤں میں یار نماز پڑھ لو وہ اللہ جو کریم جو بہانے ڈھونڈتا ہے بخشنے کے کہ بھائی تجھے بھائی میرا بندہ بھیا بندی کامیاب ہو کر آ جائے تو مرد بھی اللہ کے رستے میں نکلے عورتیں بھی اللہ کے رستے میں نکلے اور اس دور کے اندر اللہ رب العزت نے جو ہے یہ مبارک کام شروع کر دیا ہے دعوت تبلیغ کی نام سے جس میں مرد بھی جا سکتے ہیں عورتیں بھی جا سکتے ہیں تو اس میں ہم اپنا جو ہے بڑھ چڑھ کر بے حصہ ڈالیں اللہ جانتا ہے میرا سارا جان مال وقت دین کے اوپر لگ جائے اور لوگ ایمان کے اندر داخل ہو جائیں تو اللہ جانتا ہے سستا سوتا ہے اس کے لیے بھی سب مردوں سے بھی گزارش ہے مستورات سے بھی گزارش ہے کہ بھائی ہم اللہ کے رستے میں نکلیں دیر اور دور کے لیے اور جو ہے ہمارے جانے سے کتنے لوگ اگر ہم گھر میں بیٹھ زندگی ہے کتنی ساری 60-70 سال بہت ساری گزر چکی تھوڑا سا وقت اگر ہمارا جان وقت ہوگا ہم اللہ کے رستے میں نکلیں اور ایسے لوگوں تک جو اللہ سے دور ہیں اور نماز بھی مطلب نماز سے بھی دور ہیں دین سے بھی دور ہیں تو اس تک ہم پہنچ جائیں اور جو ان کا تعلق اللہ کے ساتھ ہو جائے اور وہ بھی جہنم سے بچ کر جنت میں جانے والے بن جائیں تو اللہ ہماری بھی دنیا بھی بنائے گا آخرت بھی بنائے گا اور کتنے اگر تھوڑا سا انسان تھوڑی دیر کے لیے صرف یہ سوچ لے کہ بھائی میرے جانے سے ایک میری منت کرنے سے کسی کے پاؤں کو ہاتھ لگانے سے اگر وہ اپنی زندگی تبدیل کر دیتا ہے اور اللہ کی اطاعت کے اوپر کھڑا ہو جاتا ہے اور جو اللہ کا نافر جو اللہ کو نہیں مانتا اتنے کریم رب کو جو نہیں مانتا جو بخشنے کے بہانے ڈھونڈتا ہے کہتا ہے کہ آ تو صحیح میں تجھے بخش دوں پر پھر بھی اس کو جا کے تعارف نہ کرانا تو کتنی بڑی اس کے لیے بھی سب اللہ کے رستے میں نکلنے کی نیت اور ارادے کرے امین صاحب اسکیل کر لے کہ ساتھی کھڑے ہو جائے نام لکھوا دیں نقد اللہ کے رستے میں جو ہے 4 مہینے کی جماعت چلے کی مستورات سے گزارش ہے کہ چلہ ہمارے مستورات کی جو جماعتیں جاتی ہیں وہاں پر جو ہے جہاں جو ہے نقد اللہ کے رستے میں ماشاء اللہ 4 تاریخ کو جو ہے یہ اجتماع بھی آ رہا ہے, وہاں سے بھی جماعتیں نکلیں گی نقد 4 مہینے کی, جو ساتھی بھائی اللہ کے رستے اللہ کے خزانوں پر نظر رکھتے ہو نقد اللہ کے رستے میں 4 مہینے لگانے کی نیت اور ارادہ کریں, اور 3 دن ماہ بارہ مستورات میں اور چلہ اور مرد حضرات ہر سال 4 مہینے اور اس کی بھائی نیت اور ارادہ کریں.
Yeah, that's fine.